In the previous tutorial, we set up our development environment and we created our initial, yet still empty, SAP Cloud Application Programming Model project. Now, in this tutorial, we want to progress with our project and specifically create database artifacts using core data services for SAP HANA Cloud. Now, in this tutorial, we're going to be using both the SAP Cloud Application Programming Model and its primary language, Core Data Services, or CDS, and we're going to use those tools to generate SAP HANA Cloud basic database artifacts. You're going to be learning how to use SAP HANA, how to use the SAP Cloud Application Programming Model and its syntax of Core Data Services to create simple database entries. We're going to have tables and views and relationships between them by the end of this exercise. And you're going to learn how to define database agnostic artifacts in the persistence module, in this case that will deploy to SAP HANA, but could be deployed to other supported database types of the Cloud Application Programming Model as well. Now, we're going to start here by creating some database artifacts. Now, when we create database artifacts, we do it in an abstracted way, in a model approach, using core data services as the syntax to define them. So we're not going to be writing SQL statements like, you know, create table or something like that. We're going to define what we want as the end results, and we're going to let the system and the Cloud Application Programming Model generate the necessary SQL statements for us to get us to that state. Therefore, we won't differentiate between create and alter, for instance. We'll simply define what we want the end state to be, and the compiler of inside the Cloud Application Programming Model will figure out how to get us to that point. This allows us to also be database agnostic. In other words, work with multiple databases. At the same time, when you use this database agnostic approach, you're not locked into nor using HANA Cloud-specific features. Later, we're going to show you how to mix in HANA Cloud-specific constructs and capabilities into your agnostic data model. So you can keep most of your application data model database agnostic and only drop down into HANA specifics when you absolutely need to. Now, to start this off, we want to create two tables with some basic types. And I can just come here to the DB module, and I'm going to start by creating a new file. And I want to name this file interactions.cds. It's the file extension .cds that tells it what kind of syntax that we're expecting, that it's part of the Cloud Application Programming Model and it's going to accept the core data services syntax. And let's just start with some sample that we have here in the tutorial. Oh, that didn't copy. Paste it, there we are. We're going to declare a namespace that all of our objects will be created within. We're going to take a type from the reusable type libraries of the Cloud Application Programming Model. This common module contains many reusable types. We're going to use the country region reusable type. We're going to define some local types of our own, like a business key, an sdate, an ltext with the date and time or string. Then we're going to define a header entity. This will become one of our tables. Define the keys of that table and the various columns. We're going to define an item, an interaction items entity. This would be a second table. And already you see we're defining the relationship between these two tables. We're going to say that the header table is a composition of many items within it. That means the items entity cannot really exist outside of a header. So we're not only creating a one-to-many relationship, we're defining the cardinality, we're defining the type of the relationship, that it is a composition. So when we delete the header, an instance of the header record, it will automatically delete any of the associated items or connected items. At the same time, we've got a backlink here by saying association to interactions header. We've got a way of navigating from the item and get details about the header that is its parent. So that will help us later. And what you'll see is this is going to generate views in the database that allow us to access both header and item data together as one unit. It's going to allow navigation at the OData level. simply by defining this relationship at this very abstracted level. We're not declaring join types or anything like that. The compiler, again, will generate all that for us. Now, while we're in here building our basic data model, let's also come here and define our initial service. So I'm going to go here to the SRV folder, and I'm going to create a file again. And I'm going to call this one interaction-srv.cds. This is where we're going to put our service definition. And I'm just going to put a little syntax in here. It's a little, okay. Get that to copy. There we are. We're going to tell it use the data model from our other file, from go back up one folder, go down to DB, and then go to interactions. So that's going to reference the existing data model we've already defined in the other file. We're going to define a new service named catalog service. We could really call this whatever we wanted here. And we're going to expose both the header and the item entity as projections on the underlying data model. We could make manipulations or add in additional things, create additional relationships. Basically, we're just going to do a straight projection of the two underlying tables. And everything we define in that data model about the relationship between them, the composition, that all is automatically pulled into the service definition. We don't need to do anything else. All right. Now, the editor auto-saves as we go, but if you, you can always also manually save it. The editor wasn't dirty, it didn't have the little icon, so we know that we're all saved here. At this point, we want to compile our project. And we can do that from the command line by issuing the command cds build. And this is going to look at our project structure, read the two definition files that we gave it, and it's going to build into a target gen folder. It's going to build for HANA, and it's going to build the service for Node.js. And it gives us a summary of what all it did, but we can go ahead and we can look at that. It's just another folder here in our project where it's inserted these artifacts. And we look at, for instance, in gen.db source, and then there's another gen folder inside there. It has created HDB table and HDB view artifacts. And many of them here, we only defined a couple, but it exploded that out and created everything that's going to be necessary at the database level to represent what we asked it to do. And you see, now we see, SQL being generated. We see column table. This would be like a create column table. The definitions, the data types are mapped to the HANA-specific data types. We used, let me go back up here, source, interaction, CDS. And you can see we use, for instance, string. Integer, that's the abstracted CDS data types. When it compiles down to the HANA-specific data types, nvarchar, second date, but it also brought over the relationships, the many-to-many join, the many-to-one join to countries, exploded out the whole country definition just by us pulling it in and using that data type. So this is the power of what we're getting with the cloud application programming model. Is to be able to abstract the database artifacts and the particular database that we're working against. If we were to then do a CDS build and target Postgres, for instance, it would create a different set of artifacts in our gen folder. Now, we're ready to deploy these to the HANA database. We want to see what they actually look like when they go into the HANA database. So let's bring up the SAP HANA projects view here, and I'm just going to move it up here so it's a little easier to see in the video. And what we see here is, all right, we've got a definition for an HDI container, but it is not connected yet to a HANA database. I can tell that the little icon here is the plug. It isn't plugged in yet, and if I mouse over, it says bind, so it wants to bind it to a HANA database. We are not bound yet to a HANA database. So the first thing we need to do is bind it. And this is going to create a connection to our HANA database. It's going to create an HDI container within that HANA database. It's going to create the service at the Cloud Foundry level that allow us to access that HDI container. And it's going to store all the configuration necessary for our project to be able to connect to it. So I'm just going to say bind to an HDI container. That's what we want to use. And at this point, I could connect to an existing HDI container, but these are part of other projects. I don't want to take over one that's already part of another project. I want to say, let's create a new service instance. And it's going to default in a name, and you can go with this name. There's nothing wrong. It makes sure that it's a uniquely generated name. I'm going to shorten it for the purposes of this tutorial. That was a little long, and we're going to have to type this later, so I find it's just easier if I go ahead and shorten the name. So I'm going to give it an easier, shorter name, and I'm going to hit enter. And at this point, the Business Application Studio is calling out using the Cloud Foundry API and the CLI, and it's connecting the HANA database, and it's creating the HDI container, which means it's creating a schema, or multiple schemas in the HANA database. It's creating the technical users we will use to connect to the HANA database. It is then also creating a service in Cloud Foundry that will make it easy to connect to that HDI container. And it's going to store all the configuration that we need in order to connect to that container. Now we'll take 30 seconds to a minute or so to complete here. So we'll give it just a second to finish up. All right, and now I actually got an error that it was unable to bind. This sometimes happens if the timing is off here, it didn't wait long enough for the service to get created. It will still be created in the background. It just didn't get to save the configuration. When this happens, this is easy enough to correct from, and it's actually good that the error happened to me. I can show you how to correct it. You just go ahead and click the bind again and start the process over. But this time, when you get to this step, you're actually going to see the service instance that got created in the last step. You might want to wait 30 seconds or so before you restart this, because like I said, it's just a timing issue. But you'll see it's been fully created. And if you click on it, this time it's going to save the configuration, and now it's going to be fine. And we are going to allow automatic undeployment. But now I am bound. And we can see it here, the icon has changed. I'm now connected to the database. In a minute, we're gonna be able to open the HDI container and see that. But we can also come here to the command line and we can just do CF services. And what we'll see is that it has created this as a service at the Cloud Foundry level. It is a HANA HDI shared. So it has successfully created that service. And that's what's giving us our conduit to connect to the HANA database and deploy content into it. Let me just go ahead and clear that. And that's what we want to do now, is we want to go ahead and deploy the initial database artifacts here. If I just go ahead and, because it already sees everything that we have here ready to be deployed. So if you click the little rocket icon, that's the deployment. And if I click that, it's going to start the deployment process. The deployer itself is a Node.js application that runs in the shell here in the Business Application Studio. And what it has done, I'll just make this a little bit bigger so we can see it, is it has first looked up our configuration using Cloud Foundry, and that tells it how to connect to the HANA database. You know, what URL, what username, what password, certificate, all that stuff. And I'm able to then connect to the HANA database. It looks at our project then and says, okay, I see 17 new files. It sends them into the HANA database. And it looks at these, HDB view, HDB table that are almost SQL syntax. And it uses that to compile that to SQL. And then it executes that SQL against the database, creating the resulting database artifacts. So now we have a bunch of tables and views that have been created in the database. And we can see this right away if we go to the Database Explorer. That's this icon here, Open HDI Container. I click that, and it's just going to open the Database Explorer, the SAP HANA Database Explorer, in a new tab in my browser. So we'll give that a second to pull up here. There we are, it's pulled it up and it's automatically connected us to our HDI container. You can have multiple in here that you work with. I've got other projects already deployed into my HANA database, but it's set our focus on this one that we're working with here. And for instance, if we go to tables, we can see that we have our header table, we have our item table, and we've got that countries and countries text that were pulled in from the reusable type. You can also see that we have views in here that were generated based upon the definition of the relationship between the header and item table, as well as views to help with the OData service exposure and the localization if you've got multi-language fields. So let's go back to the tables though for a second. And we want to import some data in them because I can look at the structure. It matches exactly what we defined. If I look at the data, we don't have any data in the table yet. And while we could put some CSV files directly in our project and they'd auto-deploy, I also want to show you how you can load data directly from the Database Explorer. So that's the approach that we're going to take here in this tutorial. I'm just going to right mouse click on import data. So then it would target this table, and we say, yes, we want to import data. I want to pull the CSV or Excel files from my local drive. Yes, I do have a header in the first row that will tell us what columns to target. Auto detect and browse for our CSV file. And let me just go here. I've got it already saved locally. This first one is called header CSV. And if you need them, the link here is in the tutorial. If you just right mouse click on this link, it will take you to GitHub where the CSV files are stored, and you can download them from here into your local machine. That's what I did. I just downloaded them in advance. Now I can go on to the next step, and it's saying which table do we want to target. Yes, we're going to go into the header table. And the column mapping, it was able to map everything because I named the columns in my CSV file to match exactly the column names in the target table. If they don't match exactly, or if the logic can't figure it out, then you could manually map them. We're good here. And successfully saved all rows. Yes, import into the database. And it has imported the data into the database. And now, if we look at the data in that table, we'll see that we have some data. Perfect. Now, let's just quickly repeat that process for the item table. Oh, import data. From the same spot there. Item CSV. There we are. We're targeting, just double check that we're targeting the items table. Yes, we are. Everything mapped. And let's go ahead and import that into the database. And that will have imported 6 records into the item table. And that's enough for us to test around with. There we are. There's the data in our item table. And with that, we are complete with this tutorial. In the next step, we're going to go ahead and we haven't tested the service layer. It's there and it's ready to use now that we've set up the database, connected it to our project. But in the next tutorial, we'll launch the service and we'll be able to test it in a little user interface as well.